So have you seen we've involved, these are just a few of the ways that we've evolved the development cycle in Google Web Toolkit and the productivity side of the equation. So first we have the declarative UI with UI Binder, increasing that the speed in which you can iterate, the plugin for Eclipse, error checking earlier on, and also you know, we can be a little lazier by typing less code. And then third, the developer plugin is allowing that multi-browser debugging during that development cycle. So I think I actually think I got the development side of the presentation because I like demos and being able to show multi-browser debugging. But if you've ever been stuck in the car with Bruce Johnson, you know that he's very fascinated with optimizations. And so luckily, you're all stuck with me tonight as well. So we're going to spend the next part we're going to talk about is the development time, and deployment time, and the optimizations that go on with Google Web Toolkit and performance, making apps faster. So with that, I'd like to invite up Bruce Johnson, the co-creator and tech lead of Google Web Toolkit.
Thank you, Andrew. And now you're stuck with me. But I'll try to make it interesting anyway. Again, to reiterate, back in terms of this big picture diagram, Andrew showed you the development process, fast edit refresh cycle. I'm going to be talking about what happens when it's actually time to think about deploying your app and running the compiler and so on. So it's really often the case that people call GWT a compiler, but it is important to note that really the compiler is only one small tool within the larger toolkit. As a matter of fact, the one thing you haven't seen of all the demos that you've been shown so far is you have not seen the compiler run. What you saw, again, was development mode. The whole point is to not have to run the compiler. If you stay in development mode during most of your the development cycle, most of your time is spent making edits to your Java code, hitting refresh in the browser, that's a really productive way to work, and the slow compiler doesn't slow you down at all. But at some point, it is time to start compiling into JavaScript and seeing what it's like to, you know, start to think about deploying your application. Well, I should mention, too, the JavaScript that gets produced by the compiler, it's just standard, standalone, static JavaScript files that you can serve up over any HTTP web server. But anyway, at this point, when you compile, that's when things get really interesting from a performance perspective. So if we move to the next slide, now I'm going to drill down into that even more. First, understand that the GWT compiler is not a simple Java to JavaScript source transliterator. Okay, it's a whole program optimizing compiler. I say whole program because it literally sees every single line of source code in your project when it goes to optimize and compile it. Because it can see every line of code, that means it can trace all the connections between things, all the dependencies, where methods are called, and where fields are referenced, and so on. In that kind of environment, it can do really, really aggressive and effective, thorough optimizations to make sure that the JavaScript that is produced is as small and as fast as possible. I'll walk you through the pipeline, at least a simplified version of it, in this diagram here. So starting at the left, the first thing the compiler does is it prunes out dead code. The way it does that is it starts at the entry point, which is the first method that runs when your web application can load. And it is able to see all the methods that could be called transitively from that entry point method. It can determine that certain methods would never be called. In large libraries, that's often the case that you only use a subset of the code, right? So it trims all the methods that are not called in your project and completely discards that code. It never ends up in your JavaScript. But it's not just methods. It's, you know, fields that never get read. Or if you declare local variables or parameters that never get referenced, it trims those out as well. Even entire classes, no matter how much code you write, if the class is never instantiated and never used, it goes away. It's kind of an interesting contrast to the way that you normally think about JavaScript development, where there's a library that you include on the page, right? And it's got a certain size, and that's just the price of entry. This works exactly the opposite. You only pay for the code that you actually use. No matter how large the set of libraries that you compile against, only the code that you actually need is included. OK, so that's dead code removal. Moving on to devirtualization. Well, what does that mean? In large code bases of the sort that we're talking about tonight, you need to use object-oriented design patterns. And that involves, you know, multiple levels of abstraction, class hierarchies, and so on. Well, that's great from a maintainability standpoint and a design standpoint, but those concepts, those abstractions have some runtime cost, but not if you're using the GWT compiler well, because it can go through and tighten the types of things. So you declare a variable as a shape, but the compiler sees it's ever only assigned a circle object. So it tightens the type from shape to circle, and therefore methods that are called on that object are not polymorphic. They're actually known to be calling a particular implementation of that method. And as a result, we can move on to the next box, which is inlining. Many of these methods, typically getters and setters or other small computational methods, are small enough that it's actually very effective to simply inline the bodies of those methods at the call sites. Sometimes that even means the JavaScript is smaller, because very small function bodies, when you inline them, saves you the actual characters of the word function. Well, you know, in JavaScript, every character that you include in your script actually costs you download time, right? So sometimes inlining can actually make your code smaller too. And of course, it makes it faster. Then, once you've inlined all these call sites, you end up with expressions like 2 plus 2. It really happens a lot. Or string concatenation, where you're appending a string literal to another string literal, in which case the compiler can do static expression evaluation. So if it sees 2 plus 2, for example, it simply replaces that with the literal 4. And you can easily see why that's a good thing. 4 is less JavaScript to download. It's less operation that needs to be done at runtime. So it's just basically nothing but a total win as far as you're concerned. And that's not all. As we've moved through this pipeline once, we've unlocked additional optimizations. So we go start at the beginning again, and we go back through the pipeline. And a typical project, a large project, like the ones we're talking about tonight, may go through this cycle 7 to 10 times, after which there's just nothing else that you can improve from a logical standpoint. And then it's time to generate JavaScript. And of course, when we generate the JavaScript, we eke out every little bit of size improvements that we can. So you have minified JavaScript, which means you don't have comments in the output. You don't have extraneous spaces. We even read the JavaScript spec, which I do not advise. But if you read it, you'll see there's things you can leave out, semicolons in certain places and so on. And we try to do all of that so that you don't download, your users don't download a single byte that they don't have to. And then we can obfuscate the identifiers, shorten names, again, smaller script, downloads faster, and actually can execute faster too. So that's what it's like to be locked in a car with me. but thank you for your patience. So we'll take a step back. I'll de-geekify for a second. And this is the one I want you to actually remember. The compiler smushes the heck out of your code. The diagram shows on the left the complete source for a Java project that you can compile with GWT, 2-point font. On the right side is the JavaScript code that was produced by the compiler, also 2-point font. The main thing to remember is it's okay for your Java source to be bigger because the compiler will make it smaller. And actually, this has pretty big implications for how you work to develop a large, sophisticated application. Right? You want to be able to write the Java code that you want. You've got a whole team working on this. You need design patterns. You need to be able to have, you know, modular code, maintainable code, testable code. You don't want to have to be sweating performance with every single line of code that you write. And you can work that way with GWT. You can know that the compiler has your back because it's going to take all that Java source that you write and smush it down as small as it can go. Another exciting thing, and Matt alluded to this earlier, and GWT existing users have always been excited about this, as has the team. When you have a GWT project and you upgrade to the new version, we add new compiler optimizations every time. You simply upgrade, recompile, and your application gets smaller and faster. So we've already talked to teams who've used the release candidate of 2.0, and they've reported 3% reductions in size, all the way to 20% reductions, and even more in some cases. You heard Matt say they got a 20% size reduction. So if we're doing our job right, you never have to think about any of this stuff ever again after tonight. You just write the code that you want, and you can be sure that the compiler is going to optimize it well for you. But as you continue to build larger and larger applications, you know, this takes a lot of code, right? Lots of features means lots of code. Even the best compiler optimizations can't make that free, although we will try. But, you know, eventually the JavaScript gets big and the initial download starts to take too long. And that's not what we want. We do not want users using web applications to feel as if they're having to install something in order to start your application, right? These are web applications. You should click a hyperlink and they should start immediately. So there's obviously some tension here. You want rich, full-featured applications, but you want them to start immediately. So what do? Well, I'm happy to say that in GWT 2.0, we have a solution to this. You can get incremental app download using a technology we call developer-guided code splitting. It's available in GWT 2.0. We think about it like watching a movie online. You obviously don't want to have to download the entire movie before you can start watching the first bit of it, right? You want the movie to start immediately and download the rest as you go. That's the idea behind code splitting. A real-world example of this came from Google Wave, who last October got in touch with us to say, hey guys, you know, we love GWT, but you know, we have an awful lot of functionality planned for Wave. And this is what the size of our initial download looks like as we continue development. So I don't know if you can see this in the back, but the y-axis has this curve starting to approach 1.5 megabytes of uncompressed JavaScript. Well, that starts to get to a size that is really too large to download quickly. And that would really harm the user experience, and that is no good. So I'll admit I kind of laughed nervously as the tech lead, Adam Shook, mentioned something about having to ship Wave on a CD-ROM, and I use that joke every opportunity I get because actually it's kind of an interesting reminder that the world has really changed in the last few years, right? When shipping software on a CD-ROM is literally a joke. Anyway, this is how it works. You have the entry point method in your project, which I discussed earlier. That's the top of this tree, okay? The entry point method calls other methods, which in turn call yet other methods. It's not important that you read the names of these methods. I just wanted to make the point that it is shaped like a tree, in other words, like a sort of a triangle. Now we can zoom out. And the point is the size of the initial download is proportional to the area of this triangle, essentially. So the more code that is reachable from your entry point, the bigger your initial download. What we want to do is find portions of code within this triangle, sub-triangles, if you will, that we can chop out, that we can defer, so that we don't have to load them immediately. So in this example, the triangle I'm showing you is the mail sample application. And I think a good thing to chop out is that silly about dialog box that Andrew showed you earlier. I mean, you know, it's nice to have it, but how often do you click on the about dialog box, right? Why would you make the initial download take longer just to have this kind of low value feature at the ready? It would be better if you can defer the dialog box code until you actually have someone click on the about link. So I'm going to show you what that looks like in Eclipse. All right. So the first thing you do is you find the place in the code that you think you'd like to do some chopping. So in my case, it's the spot at which we have an event handler here. Okay, this is one of those UI handler-based event handlers that Andrew showed you earlier. It's nice and succinct, and it's really clear that if this method could be deferred, then everything it depends on could also be deferred. In other words, the compiler would have an opportunity to cleave out that subtree that I showed you in the diagram. Really, the point of this demo is just to show you how few lines of code it takes to pull that off. There's a new magic method in GWT 2.0 called runAsync. And you just turn what was a method call into a callback. Okay, so what happens is one of two things when this, what we call a split point, occurs. The necessary additional code is fetched successfully, in which case execution continues. All right, that was the original method. Or it is possible that if the network has a problem of some sort, then you know the code might fail to work, in which case you want to do some really world-class error handling. And that's it. I'm done. I'm not even going to show you the thing in action, because the point is it's exactly the same. It'll feel exactly the same. But if we go back to the slides, I'll show you what I did. That smaller triangle, I chopped it out with, I guess, when you exclude braces and blank lines in the sample code I showed you, that's maybe 3 or 4 lines of code. 3 or 4 lines of code, I reduced the startup by 13%, and I did that in about a minute. So now imagine what happened when we gave code splitting to the Wave team, okay, which we did. And moving on to the next slide, this is what happened to their startup size a few weeks after we gave it to them. So in several weeks, they were able to, in preparation for the launch at I.O. this earlier this year, they reduced their startup size by a factor of 7. And so it went from 1,400K uncompressed to 200K uncompressed. When you actually serve this JavaScript, of course, you compress it, right? So 200K gzipped is about 80K, which is about the size of a typical graphic, you know, a JPEG that you would include into any old HTML page without thinking twice about it. In other words, this is, you know, very rich functionality and a very small download. That is what I call a bargain. So that's the Wave example.